I can see people in the waiting room.
Yes, ma'am, we are admitting them.
Leela ma'am, meanwhile, can I ask you how you got attracted to this field?
What attraction? Who knew about this field?
That's it. Because in our times, it was a dream which is beyond achievable for many of us.
I was in the first batch, so I had nobody to dream. No, there was nobody who could say that, okay, get into the service. No, women were not allowed unless you.
Very true.
So it was just a job for me. That's all. To tell you, to be very honest, that is how I got into this application, and then. Then the thing of, okay, I'll tell you, actually, I will be covering this.
Okay.
No?
During our discussion, let it come out.
Yeah, of course. So yes. I am covering this during my talk also.
Okay.
Because I think it's, all said and done. With Women's Day, I think I should put across that thing, you know, that we broke so many barriers at that time.
True.
So, Vaishak should have actually scheduled my talk yesterday. It would have been.
Yes, ma'am. But according to the speaker timings, yesterday also, sir had some problems presenting in the business.
Actually, we were discussing. Vaishak had put up this across to me, but last moment change was slightly difficult for us.
It's okay. Women's Day is every day, not just on 8th March.
Yes, ma'am. Actually.
That's excellent.
So yeah, it was, this is like how many years back? 91, 92 is when I joined.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't easy. Nobody even dreamt that I come from a very simple family background. And
usually we used to think this is meant for those who have got the family background in army or navy or something. That conception was there with us.
No. It's a totally different entry, you know. The process is so scientific. There you cannot have, and it's a very, very, you know, what should I say, specific purpose. It's not like somebody can study, like we are doing engineering, so okay, you can pay money and you can just study and submit assignments and do. No, here it's a different ball game altogether. Here you have to perform and you have to survive that, you know. It's not something that you can get it from the book, or you know, I can say, okay, read chapter 22 and then you are going to move. Yeah, so it's not at all that way. That is the thing.
Yeah.
That is why you can't have the vasta to get into this. You may clear the test. You may clear the test, but the rest of it, that is the SSB, is the trickiest part actually of the whole process.
So when you see now the proportion of gender proportion now almost equal, right?
No.
Still we are lagging behind.
I wouldn't call it lagging behind. No, I don't think we should ever think of it that way. You know, what are we lagging behind? We got an opportunity so late. So there's nothing like lagging behind. I think it's an awareness that the awareness is not there so much, you know. So like your school is having this as a career seminar and you are calling people or whole. I don't think people in everywhere is like, you know, doing that. All schools are doing that where children are made to, I mean, get, like, okay, first hand from me if you are getting it. Okay,
True. Like that inspires a lot, especially yes, the youngsters.
So, correct. So I don't think people are really informed. My children know about this service or this career option because of me. And people who know me, they know. But another person or maybe like in your school, how many people would know about this as a career? Everybody after 12 wants to do engineering medical.
Yeah, that is the notion which we want to break.
Yeah, high time, actually. It's high time. There's so much more that one can do. And today's kids are so lucky, I say. They're so lucky. They have, they have nothing to stop them. And so many areas where they can get into it. During our time,
areas are there, ma'am, but the equal determination, focus, that is where is the challenge lies, I think.
So when you give too many options, that is what happens. So we have many options. That's why we selected was like, okay, I'm sticking to this. Today's children are, they'll try this, then they want to go there, then they want to go there, they want to move back, they want, because they know they can survive here also, they can survive there also. So you find children studying engineering, doing engineering, and also side by side having their own startup. So I must say, the very vibrant generation.
Okay. But Vaishak?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. We can start now.
We can get more Leela ma'am with kids so that they can also benefit. So shall we begin?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Dear students, let us move to the third series of sessions of motivational speech and career awareness session, which we have started from Sunday onwards. Very hearty welcome. And we are super excited to have Miss Leela Shaju with us, one of the ex-Indian Air Force officer, one of the pioneer women officers in Air Force, and lot more, a very resourceful person to inspire each of us. So get best out of ma'am, because ma'am, as I was having a very comfortable talk with her, ma'am is very, very reachable to each of us. So after the talk, feel very free to ask whatever you have. It has, you know, Defense Force, it has its own charm, its own challenge. So make best of the session. And very hearty welcome to you on behalf of the entire DMS management and staff and students. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Special welcome, ma'am, on behalf of our principal, ma'am, Ms. Padmini. She is also there in the session.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Hello, everybody. And yes, it is indeed a moment or a, I won't say privilege or pride or anything, but I think it is beautiful that I can interact with students who are, you know, getting ready to go there into the big bad world. Right, so what is the procedure? I think I will, how I'll go about this whole thing is that I will start with a presentation wherein I will give you the basic info about the defense service sector. And then I will definitely share my experience in the organization. And after which I think the floor will be open for questions. And I'm hoping that there will be a lot of interaction. Right, so maybe start.
Sure,
I can now go on to my presentation. So I'll be sharing screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, so that's don the uniform, and yes, that's the name of my topic or my talk is going to be on this. How many of you want to don the uniform? And if you want to don the uniform, do you have it in you? Right, so now the Indian Armed Forces is basically comprises the, if you see on, is my cursor visible? This is,
yes,
this is, yeah, this is the logo or the insignia of the Indian Armed Forces. The whole of the Indian Armed Forces, it comprises not only the Indian Army, Indian Navy, and the Indian Air Force, it also has paramilitary services, but I will not be talking about paramilitary services. The paramilitary services are would be one another segment of the of another, it's like a totally different career option, right? So first and foremost, we need to know who the organization heads are, and we have the Supreme Commander of the Indian Air Armed Forces, and he is no one but the President. So we all owe all our allegiance as the armed forces, whether you are in the Army, Navy, or any of the paramilitary, he is the Supreme Commander. And in 2019, like after the Kargil war, if you, I don't know how many of you all remember, but the Prime Minister, he changed the structure and introduced what we have, the Chief of Defense Staff of the Indian Armed Forces. And General Bipin Rawat, he was the Chief of Air Staff at that time, and he had just retired, and he has been made the CDS or the Chief of Defense Staff. So under the President we have now, why this was done is because most of the operations, or rather, see, if you see war-wise, the last war was somewhere in 71, and after which we've had a very peaceful reign, or rather peaceful era. And it was during the Kargil that a lot of these operations we found were not, just specific to the branch, that is Air Force operations or the Navy or just the Indian Army. So in order to bring all three together, there was a need for somebody who will be able to regulate inter-service coordination and cooperation. And so General Bipin Rawat, he's the first CDS actually, and this was, I think, 2019 December that this whole concept of the CDS came up. So we have Army. The Army is the oldest army, oldest organization out of the three, and followed by the Navy. Air Force is relatively new, and so these are the three leaders or the chiefs, the Chief of Army Staff, the Chief of Naval Staff, and the Chief of the Air Force. And I'm not going into too much about them because I think their uniforms and everything says a lot. But yes, they are there because they have done far more than any one of us have. Yeah, moving on now to what and how we can enter the service. So to get into the service, we have two categories of entry. That means either you are a graduate. If you're a graduate, then you can enter. Obviously, because my present, my audience here are all going to be in the next category, I'm not going to be talking too much about this category. But yes, if you do your graduation, don't think that you can't get into the service. You can. Okay, so this is the combined defense services exam. This is the one which allows anybody and everybody to join the Indian Air Force or the Indian Navy or So the CDS is conducted by the UPSC, and what happens after you take the test, you are allowed to, you're further training. If you join the Army, then IMA, Indian Military Academy. If you join the Navy, you go to the Indian Naval Academy. If you join the Air Force, it is in the Air Force Academy. And you also have the option of going to the Officers Training Academy. Now, the Indian Military Academy and the Officers Training Academy are both for the Army. You might be wondering, why do they have two of them? Well, Indian Military Academy is for those who pass the NDA. Those who come out of NDA and then move in to become an Army officer. So a lot of you may not know, I will be covering it, in the next slide. The NDA actually trains these students for all the three services. So after you finish your NDA, then you choose whether you want to go to the Army, Navy, and the Air Force. And of course, you have your performance also. So those who pass out from the NDA are those who go into the military academy. And those who clear or enter the Army through the CDS, they are the ones who get into the OTA or the Officers Training Academy. So if you join after graduation, then you will into the Army, then you will be going to the OTA. Right now, there is a written exam. For all of these, there will be a written exam, then there will be an SSB, and SSB is a Services Selection Board. Okay, again, that is the most important part of getting into the service sector. I will be taking that also. Then the medical exam and medical examination, we all have the height, weight, and medical health and hearing, sight, all of these things will be tested. And finally, you are shortlisted. List is made and you enter this. So this is for entry into all the three branches. One test for all the three. Now, besides this, the Indian Navy and the Air Force, they take their own tests also, which means that if you are focused only on the Indian Navy, you can take this test. Those who want to go only to the Air Force, they can also take this. So you can take both the CDSE and the Air Force. You can take both the CDSE and the Indian Navy test or the INET, or you could take all the three, right? So now what happens with the INET? INET is, again, now this is only for males, okay? Both the INET and the Air Force common admission test is for both, but the Indian Navy is for men, and they have a test which is conducted twice a year, and you have to go through SSB, you have to go through. So the process of selection is this: a test followed by the SSB, then you have the medical. There is an interview. Yes, between the SSB and the medical, there is an interview, which is a dreaded interview. And finally, of course, the shortlisting. If you see in the AFCAT, as it is called, the AFCAT, you also have, since graduates are there, even engineering graduates can opt for the Air Force as a career. There are two ways. Now, if you are studying engineering in an engineering college, campus placements happen. So that is one way you can get, wherein you'll third year of engineering and your career, you're done. But if you don't get through the campus, then you can take this test, and there is a separate EKT or an engineering knowledge test, which you have to take if you have to, if you want to join as a technical officer, right? So I'm not going into too much of factual information on these because this is after graduation, but yes, the 10 plus 2 level and the NDA exam, this is for 16 and for those who are 16 and a half to 19 and a half, again, not open to women. And minimum qualification, a 10 plus 2 with physics and math. Now, physics and math is compulsory if you want to, if you intend to, you know, it's a feeder. This is like a feeder to the three services. So the training is such that you are trained for all the three services. And then in the third year, they are asked to bifurcate. So you can go to the Air Force, you could go to the Navy, or you can go to the, but those who have physics and maths, only those children, those who have studied physics and maths in your 10 plus 2, only they can opt for the Navy and Air Force. Right, but for the Army, there's nothing. Any you can a 10 plus 2, any 10 plus 2 can appear for it. Now, what happens once you clear this test? Karakwasla, that's in Pune, and there is a 3-year. It's like a graduation program. A normal BSc BA degree is what you are awarded at the end of your 3 years. Don't think that you become an officer after NDA. No, you don't. Okay, so those who are entering into the NDA or they want to get into the NDA, please understand it is like you're preparing for becoming an officer. So it's not that obviously you will become an officer. It's like your LLM. When you do your LLM, there is that 5-year course. Or you have a 3-year course. Some people do a normal graduation and then do the LLM. Whereas some of them, they do just the 5-year course and they have done the BA, LLM, the BA and the LLB. I mean, the BA, LLB and LLM all put together. So here also, it is like a 3-year course that you have to go through. And then you have the option of choosing which one you want to trifurcate into. Very, very rigorous training. And probably that's the reason why the women have not yet been entertained. Very, very rigorous. And there are enough number of YouTubes, where NDA people have told about their training. It's very, very rigorous. All right. So now there is another way of entering after 10 plus 2, you want to join the Army. So if NDA is one way where you can join all three. Now you want to join the Army, but you don't want to wait for your graduation and then go for CDSE. You want to get into the Army straight away, but as an engineer. So Army engineers, if you are opting for Army engineering, the technical branch, you can appear for the test, that is the technical entry. The scheme and again PCM. So we have the PCM that is to be taken, and again you have the SSB. Now the SSB centers will be only for the Army, so therefore that's in Bhopal, Bangalore or Allahabad. These are the three places where they will call you for SSB. I will speak about the SSB in detail. So at the time, the SSB is the Services Selection Board, as you can see over here. This is the Services Selection Board. And what exactly it is, I will talk about it. So the courses here in the tests or even in the NDA, there are twice, 6 months. Every 6 months, a new intake comes, a new batch, a new course. We call them courses. So the first course, and we are even, if you see my the first slide I had put in as 1SSCW. That is the first short service commission. SSC is short service commission. And short service commission, SSCW, women. So that's, so we are identified by our courses. And so the first batch of... so even in the NDA, they have courses 142, 152, 162. And I think it is the 147th course that is running. I'm not very certain, but somewhere around there. Okay, and now all these people who have done from the NDA, they will get permanent commission from the NDA as well as from the technical, this thing. They're all eligible for permanent commission. A permanent commission and a service, short service commission are the two kinds of commission. We are talking about officers in the Indian Air Force or the Navy or the Army. And we have another category, which we call the, who are the backbone actually. And these are the non-commissioned officers and the other ranks, ORs, which we call them ORs. Now, the again, I'm only concentrating on the officer ranks here. So to become a officers are given a permanent commission or a short service commission, and for a permanent commission is 20 years service, whereas for a short service commission for different branches, it's a different year, different duration, 5 years, 7 years, 9 years, and so on. So for TESS and NDA, right? So they're just a small the comparison that I have here between NDA and the TESS. So obviously in an NDA, you're getting a BA or a BSc degree, whereas in a TESS, you are becoming an engineer. And with NDA, you can join all three branches of the service. And with TESS, you can only join the army. Just give me a minute. Huh? My doggy wants to go out. 1 second.
Students, just a reminder, feel free to
I'm so sorry. Yeah, that, I have a dog and he just wanted to go out. Yes, so you can, so you get within NDA all the three. You can join any one of the three services, whereas TESS is technical. Where is NDA? Kharagpur, Pune. But with TESS, you have to go to OTA in Gaya. And after 5 years, all right. So the first year will be in OTA Gaya, and then the 4 years will be different specialized. Again, under the technical branch, they have many specializations. So they have Army Engineer Technical Colleges where you will be sent for your training. NDA people, generally, they are given a lot of preference in all the three services. So if you are an ex-NDA, that's how you'll be an ex-NDA. That means you have you are like 3 years senior to somebody who's come in through from the graduate path. Like, you know? So what he did during his graduation, you have also done the same graduation, but you have been introduced and you have been programmed for service. So that advantage the NDA students definitely have, right? So this is just now the same way we have the Navy also. In the Navy also, you can go and become a tech engineer in the Navy, right? After your 10 plus 2. So after your 10 plus 2, you can become an engineer in the Army or in the Navy, not in the Air Force, okay? You cannot become an engineer. You cannot do an engineering degree with the Air Force. And Air Force only takes those who have done engineering in some other college, some reputable, whatever. This college doesn't matter, but some of them get through the campus placements, and the others have to come in through the CDS, right? But both Army and Navy allow, or rather they it's like they have their own college of engineering. So these, again, 4 year, what do you get if you join the Navy? It's a 4 year BTEC in applied electronics and communication, mechanical engineering, as well as electronics and communication. And these are very specific to Navy requirements. Just like that, even for the Army, it's the same. Again, a BTEC degree, JNU is the university which awards the degree. And yes, it is. This is a test conducted by the UPA again, right? So therefore, what you have, if you want to enter the Navy, you have basically the NDA or the NA exam. Now, NDA exam, it takes, allows you to even go in to the Naval Academy. It doesn't mean that you only go to Kharagpur. If there are students who can opt for Navy straight away after the examination. And the Naval Academy is located at a place called Erimala. That's near Kannur in Kerala. And that's where the training for these, even those who join through the, I mean, those who join for the technical training in the Indian Navy, they all get trained at Naval Academy, Erimala. So if you want to do the engineering degree from Naval Academy, two ways that you can get into it. One is, of course, the NDA and the NDA exam, but you will be taking it for entry into Naval Academy. So the advantage of taking the NDA exam is that you may clear the NDA exam, so you can opt for NDA, from where you can then try go into one of the, if you're not decided, but if you are very keen, yes, I want to do just these things. These are the, then you write the Naval, the NDA and opt for the Naval Academy. Right. Whereas the other one is by opting for the 4-year course that they are providing. Remember, it is the JEE Main. I think from 2017, they've started accepting the scores of your JEE Main. So based on that, they will, based on your scores, they will call you for a service for the SSB. Right. So then while in your application process, when you are applying for your JEE Main, if you want to be considered for the Indian Navy BTEC course, you will have to make that, check that option. So this is actually something very nice, I would say, because it's something that has gotten recently introduced, I think 2017 or 18. Otherwise, you have to write so many tests. So one test and then you can think of going where you want. So those who think that the JEE is very tough and just think, no, don't think like that. Just take it. And there are so many options after that using this score. Right. Now, how do I get into the Air Force? Unfortunately, Air Force doesn't allow anybody to come in after the 12th standard. So you cannot do anything except go through the NDA. So after 12th, now the reason I will tell you is because there is a lot more maturity and skill required when you talk of the Indian Air Force, considering that you are working with some of the most sophisticated aircraft and the engines. And more than that, I think controlling the aircraft is not easy. Okay, it's not easy and it needs a very high level of maturity. There is no opportunity or no chance for you to show your gimmicks there, no. You are not up there to, you know, show your loops and show off. No, we don't need that. You have to work on orders. And these are things that that come with a little bit of maturity. The fact that, yes, when you are controlling that and then they say, fire. I mean, it is, I wish I could explain that feeling, but it is a huge sense of responsibility there, okay? And once something goes wrong, it's not just you or the organization that suffers. There is a lot more at stake, you know? So this is the reason probably that they don't permit any 10+2 to enter the Air Force after the 12. And you have to go through the NDA. Now, just clear the NDA, they make you write a PABT, what we call a PABT. That's a Pilot Aptitude Battery Test. Okay. And let me tell you this, that everybody is not cut out to be a pilot. Just because you have decided I'm going to become an Indian Air Force pilot, no. It doesn't happen that way. It's not one of the easiest things to do. And a lot of focus required. And it needs real guts, I would say. Okay, so you there are various tests that they do. Plus, there are your physical this thing, their leg length, for instance. There are people who have gotten rejected because of their leg length. So if you're too tall, you can't go onto the fighters. Remember, these aircraft are not made, you know, for you. You have to be made for that aircraft. So if your genetic influence has made you extra tall or extra short, sorry, Air Force is not for you. Okay, or pilots are not. The pilot job is not for you. So after, they have to take the pilot aptitude battery test or the PABT. And and after that, after your NDA, then you head to the Air Force Academy. And that's where you get your further training. It's in fact, in the Air Force Academy, you have training. And then life as a pilot is only training. Continuous training is what they will put you through. Now, another entry, which unfortunately none of y'all will be able to even think of. I think NCC is not there in India, but yes, you can enter the Army, the Navy, and the Indian Air Force if you are an NCC certificate holder. Okay, so it's unfortunate schools here don't have that. But yes, that's another means or mode of entry. So straight away, if you, in fact, for the Air Wing, for the Indian Air Force, if you have an Air Wing senior division certificate, come in. Okay, and that is through the NCC is a National Cadet Corps, and that is there is a separate organization, and you have to apply through that. So they take it up. That's also a military organization. We have Air Force and the Navy. I hope you all know that the Navy also has aircraft and the Army has their own aircraft. It's not just the Navy, not just the Air Force. So you have pilots, Navy pilots also. And the NCC is common too. It can be run by any one of the three services. Can anybody tell me what is this that you see? Anyone?
Rafael?
Who is that?
Atma Darshan.
Is a student, teacher?
Student.
I didn't get your name.
My name is Atma Darshan.
Atma Darshan.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Atma Darshan, fantastic. And it's pronounced Rafal, okay? It's a Rafal. And that's the latest aircraft that the Air Force has acquired. And do you know the gentleman there then, Atma Darshan?
Yes, ma'am.
Who is he?
No idea.
Okay. His name is Air Commodore Hilal Ahmed. So he's the first pilot to fly that aircraft. And I couldn't put too many pictures here, but it's such a beautiful aircraft. You must have a look at it. So huge. And he's gone down in history as the first pilot to have flown this aircraft. It came into our, this thing, I think 2019. That's when Rafal was introduced into our Air Force fleet. And he is presently in France. He's the air attached there and doing a lot in this Rafale, in the same segment. Wow, yes. Now, this is another mode of entry. Doctors, biology, doctors and nurses, who doesn't want them, which organization? And of course, the Army with Army, Air Force, Navy, of course. When I say the Army, it's basically all the three services, okay? And yes, we definitely need them. And these come under the armed forces. So they are basically an offshoot of the Army. It comes under the Army. So we don't have an Air Force doctor or a naval doctor. All of them are Army. under the army, but when they again trifurcate, and then they wear our uniform. But originally they would be from the army itself. So they again, you can you have two levels of entry, two kinds of entry, modes of entry, the AFMC cadet entry, again NEET, you have to appear for the NEET. And once your NEET score is given, then they have their own cutoffs. AFMC has its own cutoffs. I think just like all the other colleges, they have their own cutoffs. AFMC 2020 cutoffs was for boys was 618 and girls was 637, becoming difficult for girls. Somewhere I can see something very positive. Girls are cut out to be doctors, maybe the hardworking kind. So the level for girls was 637, the cutoff for girls 637, but for boys was 618. And after you write the test, again, it doesn't stop there. You have to write the TOLER. The TOLER is a test of English language. You will have, it's like, it's a CBT, about 90 questions are there, 90 minute test, and all the English language, basic comprehension, some logic questions, reasoning questions. And all this will be conducted at the AFMC. And after that test, you're taken for interview. And based on all of this, that is your NEET score, your TOEFL, your TOLER, and your interview is how you get into the AFMC. And once you are into the AFMC, I think all of you, those who are aspiring to be doctors, there is a bond, and you need to get into it with eyes open, 5 years, and then you have to work for a certain number of years. You can also go after your graduation if you are doing MBBS in other colleges. You can still enter the Air Force after that. And likewise for dentists, they have the dental, Army Dental Corps. Army Dental Corps, you only after you complete your BDS. So they don't have, but you have to complete your BDS from some recognized university, and you need a 60% for that. And you can become. Now, besides these three, of course, we have the MNS. MNS, those who take up nursing, and two ways again, you can either, you've completed your nursing from some college, you can apply. I have again focused here on those who want to do nursing in the army itself. So there is an entrance test for it's only in the army. So it's the Indian Army BSc Nursing. That's the course, it's a 4-year course. And same, you have a test, CBT, computer-based test. And where do you go for your training? It's in the College of Nursing of the Armed Forces Medical Services. This, the CON is what they, College of Nursing, Pune, College of Nursing, Kolkata, College of Nursing, New Delhi, Lucknow, and in Bangalore, and Ashwini. So after you do your nursing, nursing, you are given a short service commission. So you are commissioned officers. Now, there is a difference in the, what is a commission, if you ask me, somebody asked me, what is a commission? A commission is when you are given your rank. Okay, a rank, any military officer is known by his rank. And that just like you have a doctor known as Doctor so-and-so. And these days, even engineers are like ENG, but that's, I think, superfluous. Surely it doesn't make any sense. But doctors, they have that prefix. Likewise, the 4Gs, they have their prefix, and that is their rank with which they leave the service. So I am like an ex-flight lieutenant. So when you're awarded your rank in a parade, so we go through a parade, a passing out parade, and right on the parade, after a full rigorous parade, you are given your ranks. So that's a ceremony. And after that, such commissioning is that ceremony, you know, the commissioning ceremony, where there's a full round of parade and beautiful parade that we have. And I will share that also in my experience. and this is you're given your rank. So our shoulders are the place where you will find, whether it's the Army, Air Force, Navy, they had the epaulets, the patches or the stripes or the stars, and those, that is awarded, okay, after your training, 52 weeks of training. And then, now in the case of the MNS, they don't have the ceremony, okay? So it's just like in their in their college, there will be a small get together, and they do, there's no parade. Obviously you don't want a nurse to be parading up and down, no? Right? You want the nurse to be knowing what has to be done. You are not going to be, when you are doing a parade, there are so many things, you know, about saluting, correct way, who to salute, how to salute, when to salute. MNS doesn't want to know that. When she's at the army, when she's at war, she's not going around going and saluting 10 people. And she doesn't need to know that kind of hierarchy. So it's basically their profession which has made it like this, so that they are commissioned officers, and yet it's not considered in the same bracket. Then those who like animals, please do your veterinary course and your animal husbandry and join the Indian Air Force. Lovely dogs that you have in the Indian Army, and you will be definitely looking after all of them. So this is, if you can see the picture, this is how the commissioning ceremony of the College of Nursing is. So you don't have, it's a small, they are small batches, and in their college stage itself, they will be awarded. There's nothing like a official rank being given. So far, this is what I have covered, is how you got into the services after graduation, and then services after your 10+2. You want to get into all the three, you have ways for that. You want to get into any one of them specifically, the ways for that. You want to do an engineering minus Air Force, yes, you can do that in the Army and in the Navy. And you want to become a doctor in the Indian Armed Forces, yes, all of them come under the Army. You can become a nurse or a engineer with them. Now, does the organization have only officers? No. Okay. So we have, like I said, the commissioned officers. And then we have what we call the non-commissioned officers and the ORs, the other ranks. Okay. So the other ranks are, I don't know now whether if I use these terms, whether you will, the Jawans. Yes. You all learn, you've heard about the Jawans, right? So who are these military Jawans? In the Army, they call them Jawans. In the Air Force, we call them the Airmen. And in the Navy, they are called the Seamen. Okay, so that these are the three terms. But everybody goes by what the Army, like I said, it is the oldest organization out of the three. So Jawan means everybody is a Jawan, but it's not. It's Jawan, Airmen, and Seamen. And these are the people who do the, you know, the technicians, they are the ones who do the work. So their whole, in fact, their entry is a totally different thing. After 10th standard, you can become an airman. After 10th standard, you can become a Jawan. After 10th standard, you can become a seaman. All right. So it goes to, it's a different level of entry. And I have, obviously, we are not talking about that. You are all lucky and fortunate to have to be doing your 11th and 12th. So I don't think you should think about that as a career at the moment. But yes, that is definitely, there are lots of options in that category. And it's like the junior employees of the organization. They are the ones who actually do the work. And if you ask me, the officers are the ones who, they are the ones who plan the operation. They're the ones who will give you all the duties. They assign the duties. But the actual operation is performed with a team. And that team is comprises these non-commissioned officers. So non-commissioned officers are the senior fellows. Now, those who join straight away, they join as the LAC, leading aircraftsmen. Different branches have, the different services have different entry points, entry ranks. And then they grow and they come to the junior commission, the non-commissioned officers, and that means the senior fellows. Like if in the Air Force we had a warrant officer, he is a non-commissioned officer. In the army, you can have a subedar. So the subedars are the senior fellows. They have really worked that many years as young boys. They would have joined and then. So all these three are part of the service. Okay, so commissioned officers are the management team, the management sector. They are the ones who make the laws, make the decide the mission, decide who's going to do what. And the executing part is the non-commissioned officers are those who assist the commissioned officers. They are the senior people among the lower ranks. And finally, we have the ORs, which you call the other ranks. Yeah, this is just for you to see. These are the epaulets that we wear on our uniform. And it's very difficult to really tell you, but this is just for you to know which branch has what ranks. This is something that you get mixed up. Everyone asks, are you a captain? Okay. I can't really answer that question, but I'm an equivalent to a captain, okay? So I am equivalent to the lieutenant in the Indian Army, is a flying officer in the Indian Air Force, and he's a sub-lieutenant in the Indian Navy. So a captain in the Indian Army is a flight lieutenant in the Indian Air Force and a lieutenant in the Indian Navy, right? So you hear of group captain. Yes, who was the group captain who was recently in the news? Abhinandan?
Yes.
Yes. So the group captain, where does he come? Obviously not in the Indian Army. So you will look for group captain. He is here, four stripes. Now everything has got, if you see, as they increase the design changes. If you see here, we start with two stars in the Indian Army, three stars, then the Bharat, then this, then it goes, decorations. Okay, in this fellow, he will find stripes and a circle, stripes and a bubble, stripe and a bubble, stripe, single stripe, and goes on. Obviously, you're not supposed to know, but this is taught to you when you go undergo your training. Okay, so a group captain of the Indian Air Force is like a colonel in the army. Right, he's a colonel in the army, but now you see, he's a captain in the Indian Navy. So a captain, when you say, are you a captain? No, I can't call myself a captain because I am not in the Indian Navy or in the Indian Army. I am a flight lieutenant. So therefore, these are the different ranks that you have of the officers. And likewise, you have the similar ranking scale listing for the junior commissioned officers, non-commissioned officers, and the ORs also. Coming to my baby, the branches of the Indian Air Force, we have the flying branch and the ground duties. The flying branch, as you know, they have all the pilots. So the pilots, how do they enter? Either they are NDA, ex-NDA, or they have cleared the CDS examination. So this ex-NDA, that means they've gone through this whole routine. I mean, the whole process. And the CDS, of course, are those who have written the test and cleared it. The ground duty branch is the other branch that is, obviously, if somebody is flying, someone has to look after the equipment that is on the ground. And so ground duties has two types or two categories. One is the technical branch and the non-technical branch. technical branch are the engineers. Non-technical branch is where I fit in. I was in the education branch. So along with education, you have accounts, logistics, admin, medical, dental, all of them come under the non-technical branch. Yes, and also after all this, what should you have? What should you possess if you want to become an officer in the defense? Number one, leadership qualities. Okay, that's me in my first posting, right? And I'm meeting the AOCNC, that is the Air Officer Commanding in Chief. He was welcoming me as on my first posting, and that was in Allahabad. So leadership qualities, yes. Now, if I could, I would really talk about leadership alone, you know. It's such an important thing and such a cliche term. Everybody just talks about leadership in such a casual manner, but it's like a whole, I can talk for 2 hours on that. So there are so many points of leadership, but the leadership qualities, if you have a love for sports and outdoor life, you cannot be one of those non-sporty kind and thing that you cannot. It has to be, you have to have that thing of going out and, you know, working out and stuff. Character self-discipline goes with this, such a noble profession, more than noble. It's all about rules. And a lot of people think that it must be very suffocating. It is not. It's it makes you so you know, what should I say, that routine gets you into a different kind of discipline, you know. It is a lot of self-discipline. Positivity, obviously, the fact that you're going to fail 10 times in doing anything and everything that you're doing there. That 1 year of training has taught me that you will fail 100 times, maybe the 101 time, but last till then. Okay. Do it 100 times without thinking that you are, even if you have lost, no, the next time is there and I'm going to get that then. So that is the fighting spirit that you have to have. You have to have ability. Now, all this is what they test in your SSB. Ability to test, to take decisions, ability to withstand pressure, of course it is, and do you have the passion to serve the country? Now, honestly, when I joined, I didn't have any passion to serve the country. And I will tell you why in my next slide, yeah? And these are the benefits which everybody likes. And what I know everybody has, everybody gets, and everybody knows. But there are some beautiful benefits that I want to highlight here, you know, that is the leave. 60 days of leave, 60 days of paid annual leave with 20 days of casual leave and 10 days of sick leave. And if you are admitted in the military hospital for anything, you are on their payroll. You can fall sick, you can suffer from cancer, you are being given free treatment and you are considered on job. So that's one thing I had. I used to get 100 days of leave when I was in the Indian Air Force. That is 80 days for sure, which I have availed, 60 days of this thing, and 60 days annual leave and 20 days casual leave. And which is very, very, very necessary for people who are working there, because that's the kind of rigors that they have to go through. The other thing is the ration, and ration comes along with another very attractive, what is that? The spirit, the liquor. Yes, ration is also comes with liquor. And that's one thing that I know all the men and nowadays, even the women, I think are all, it attracts, it is very cheap in the Indian Air Force. As a working officer, you are entitled for free ration. So I used to get about 13 kgs of rice in 1 month. This is just for you to know how much of ration we get. 13 kg of rice. I get the 60 eggs in a month, 60 eggs in a month. I get a loaf of bread every alternate day. I don't know what we all used to make bread puddings. I get milk today, if I get 1 liter, alternate day, 2 liters, and I am alone. So Anda Bhurji and this thing, Kheer, with all the milk and the rice. Anda Bhurji and Kheer is something that all Air Force wives also, the wives of the Air Force officers, they excel in that because there's so much of Anda and nobody knows. Anybody comes, hello, Bhurji, banao, khilao. Okay. So that is ration. Other things, of course, all these medical benefits. You know, one thing that I have to say is that all of your training is free of cost. So you become an engineer at 0 rupees. You become a doctor, not even your uniform. You don't have to buy even a pair of shoes or a pair of socks. Everything is provided. Your books provided. Okay, so there's nothing. You have a beautiful campus, and I would advise you to go and just have a look at those YouTube things where they have people have. I have put one link on this, I don't know whether I'll get the time to share that. Yes, and then so it's brilliant facilities that you have, lovely houses, such big, beautiful houses, fully furnished, and you have the pleasure of having the pleasure, no, I won't say the pleasure, privilege. It is a privilege. It's all your, it's like a 5-star service where you have a swimming pool, whether it's a table tennis, everything is there. Name it and it's there. Okay. So your accommodation, family is brilliantly happy when they are there because they have everything. You don't have to. You find 4G families are one of the laziest families because they don't really have to do anything. Everything is like it's available. And the post-retirement benefits, of course, which you this is the place where I am just going to go berserk with. Okay, why I chose, I will go a little fast. I know I'm a little over time, but why I chose to join the Indian Air Force, I really don't know. I wanted a job. I finished my engineering. I did my engineering in 1991. And after that, I knew that I didn't want to work as an engineer. That I was very certain because I did my electrical and electronics, and I thought that that was a very boring job to be going to work office and doing my normal switching on, switching off or whatever supervisory jobs. I was sure that I wasn't, but I had a feeling that yes, I should take up teaching as a profession, and I was preparing for my the GATE. And the GATE is in the first week of, second week of February or the second Sunday of February. And I had planned my schedule. Okay, I finished my engineering in September 1991. So I had October, November, December, where 3 months I was doing my course. For those who don't know about the GATE, GATE has got two sections, section one, section two. Section one is your basic maths, physics, chemistry, and your basic subject. So if I'm an electrical and engineering, I have a subject of electrical. And section two is your course, your actual subject. So subject is a lot. That's 4 years subs learning you have to do. So that I did my those 3 months, October, November, December. And I kept aside for the first section one, that's math, physics, chemistry. It had to be just, and I kept that for January. So that by February, I'm all set for the exam. But my bad luck, it was a very sudden death of my father, and everything. All my plans went to the tops. So he was in the hospital for about 18 days and he just died, just like that. And along with it, all my plans for the GATE also just went off out of the window because I had not looked at any of the physics, chemistry, math. Obviously once you're in, means that is my 12th standard, after 12th, 1 year of basic physics and chemistry, I had to, and the condition is that if you don't pass this part one, they will not even look at your answer paper for part two. So
1992, I see this advertisement which says calling women for to join the Indian Air Force. And one of the qualifications they said was BTech. So I took my 10 rupee envelope and sent my, because I knew I had to now think of something to do. And what caught my eye was the education branch. So there were two branches that they were offering, administration and education. What I checked, what I saw was the administration had graduation as the qualification, but whereas the other one had education, had postgraduates and professional qualifications for BTech. And I applied 22nd January, my father passed away. And I think in the first week of February, I got this call, you have to come for SSB. Now, I didn't even know what SSB was. I had no background from the air services, nobody. I applied and I forgot. And when this came, there was all hell broke loose, you know, at home. My mother had just lost my dad. My mother is a working woman, and she couldn't think of, in Malayalam, as they say, pattalam. It's not for women. No need of joining. That was her reaction, and a very strong reaction. So what do? I actually had, there was a major fight at home, and to the extent that she said, I'm not giving you money to go to Banaras, because the SSB was in Banaras, the service selection. Who's going to take you to Banaras? Nobody. We don't know anyone in Banaras. You're not going, you're a woman, I mean, girl, young girl, alone. No, 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 no. And somewhere along the way, my elder brother told my mom, she won't get, let her go. And even nothing, they're giving me up and down fare. So nothing, you're not losing anything, let her go. And that sealed it, okay. And if I say this seems funny now, but since my dad was not around, my uncle was there in Jamshedpur. Jamshedpur is where I studied, by the way. My parents were both working in the Tatas. And so from Jamshedpur, my uncle is also there. He arranged one of his juniors to accompany me to Banaras by train. So I'm not allowed to go, no, it's UP, it's not safe, etc., etc. Girl going alone, having to stay 5 days in Banaras. No mobile phones, no nothing. So this man was sent with me. He belonged to Banaras, so he stayed there while I was in the camp in the SSB. The Service Selection Board, that is my experience that I will be moving on to. And SSB is 5 days in that place. The first day that you have, first day you will be, there's a 3-hour psychological test. And some of the tests that they put you through are the situation reaction test. Has anybody, I don't know whether these terms are, situation reaction test is like, they give you a list of some 60 situations. What I remember vaguely, some of them is, I was alone in the house and suddenly I am with my younger brother and there suddenly a snake crawled in this thing. I would dash, 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 dash. Okay, then. I was alone on the road and my car broke down. I would dash, 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 dash. A whole lot of situations like that. 60 situations, 60 minutes. Okay. So that's 1 hour and 60 situations. And you have to finish it. So you are just, there is no thought process there. You're just, it's like instinct. What will I do? What will I do? What will I do? What will I do? Do, do, do. It's only when I became an education officer that I realized what was me. There were so many questions that were repeated in some form or the other. What they are checking is when you're, this is what I said, split second decisions when you are taking. This is how they'll check. And you don't remember, because in 1 minute, what is your answer? You don't remember. But after another 20 seconds, again, that same question has come. You don't know what you have written, but are you writing the same thing?
Okay, so that's one test. There was another test which we call the perception, picture perception, or the thematic aptitude. There was some. There was a picture shown, and it was displayed for a minute, and then we were given 4 minutes to write a story on it. So a picture is there. They show it to you on for a minute, and then picture goes. 4 minutes, write a story. Next picture. Immediately after that, next picture, then 1 minute is displayed, 4 minutes, write a story. Next picture, and you think, when is this going to end? 12 such pictures. So you're taking 5 minutes for one picture. The 12th picture, I still remember, was a blank picture. So we're waiting, where is the picture? That's the picture. Write a story on it. And that was exactly my state of mind at that time, after writing 11 stories. 4 minutes story, 4 minute story, 11 stories. And as the pictures, you know, they become more and more hazy and blurred and black and white and gray, and you don't know what's there. What story can you make? But you made, that we made. All those who cleared, at least made. We were, by the way, some 3 lakh applicants, and out of which 24,000 were called and only 12 were selected. We call ourselves the, not the dirty dozen, the dangerous dozen, right? So we were just 12 of us, and it was at that time really a very, 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 what should I say? Yes, a moment that I will remember. So the SSB was this, and then we had, of course, the physical training, the physical test, not easy at all. A lot of strategy. There are strategy. There's group discussion, some war plan, some. But of all this, what I remember is the 1 hour interview that I had. So one by one, one each day, they are, you know, eliminating. Okay, you can go today. First day after the psychological test, so many only are saying, the rest can go. So it's a very scary feeling. Oh my God, okay, baj gayi. Next day, after the GS physical and another test, finally, okay, you can go. So then you are there. So Tika goes down to just about maybe 100 of us. And this interview is 1 hour. And this interview is nothing like I have ever, it was a huge room. And there was this officer with 4, you know, when you don't know what these are, it's very, very, very intimidating. So he's in his uniform and he's wearing all that, and he's sitting there in a swivel chair, and he has his table, and far away is one chair where you have to sit. Again, that's also a swivel chair, fans. And he can see you, and you can see, you know, he's so casual and comfortable, and it's as if he knows you from donkey's years, but the things he makes you come out with was mind-blowing. I don't know how they are trained, of course, for the job, but that interview, everyone who went in for the interview came out saying, I never thought I could tell this person all these things. So for 4 years, I was in the engineering college, and that's where I met my husband. And so this was just in the family that was known, that it was all known, okay, that we are going to get married. But I told this gentleman about my love life and that business, when he asked me, okay, so yeah, your fiance is okay with you joining the service? I said, yeah. So these were the things. This was a kind of, there was, I remember one law graduate, she came, she says, I talked about the cases that I should never have talked about. Those are such confidential cases. But the way he was speaking and the way he takes you, he drives you into a conversation. And so it was a beautiful experience, actually. And I think they make you so comfortable that they are assessing what you are as a person, you know. Yes, then we, after all of this, get into the thing. There's 52 weeks of some beautiful training, the thrill. Oh yes, it was awesome. The ambience, the style. But behind all of that, there was some terrible moments. I remember all 12 of us have cried. Please understand that this was a first batch. Nobody knew what to do with these 12 girls. We were the, everybody was the focus of everyone's attention. Anything we did, there's so much of, not regimentation, but rules. We have to all the time run in the junior term. There are two terms. Yeah? 6 months you're junior, 6 months you're senior, because the next intake comes. So when you're senior, it's fine. But when you're junior, 6 months we are running. Wherever you cannot walk, you have to run. You're given, you'll run, and you will go get about 5 minutes to eat your food. Okay? And when you eat your food, it's not like you will grab. No, you have to use that knife and the fork and the knife. You cut the slice, one slice of bread into 6 pieces and pierce it with the fork and then only eat with all that. Who can eat? Here we have done parade for 1 hour and got up in the morning at 5 o'clock for a health run followed by a parade. And then you come thinking, I'm going to eat. And there you have to do all this. Cut it and you'll get one cutlet. If you're a vegetarian, you get a cutlet. If you're a non-vegetarian, you're given an omelet. So you cut that cutlet also into 6 pieces and take it with the fork and the knife. But we had to do it. And I still remember one of my batchmates, who's coursemates. She used to stuff bread into her pocket because she couldn't eat. She couldn't do this. So she used to slowly push it into her pocket. And then once we are in class where we don't have any seniors, our seniors are the ones who used to give us the ragda. We call it the ragda. And she used to be eating. Yeah, but then this ragda, the concept of the ragda has broken us. You know, it was broken because it is rigorous punishment. But why does this punishment happen? I have to share this with you because that is the essence of the whole service, you know, this defense service. So what is ragda? Ragda is punishment for anything. Anything and everything that you do wrong, you are given a punishment. So your punishment could be push-ups, front rolls, right? Or run so much, come back. 2 minutes, go there, come back. If you haven't reached in 2 minutes, again run, go back, turn, run. So there are, you can imagine people, we are all 24, 25 year old girls. And then running is not something that we are doing all the time, but getting on time. It was very, very, very humiliating, I would say, to know that out of the 12, okay, two of them have not made it. There was one cycling. You have to learn cycling. You have to know cycling. You don't know, okay, learn it. And you're given 1 week. So this was the kind of, the punishments that they... One such punishment was called the Patti Parade. Now, what is the Patti Parade? The Patti Parade is, you know, we have a whole lot of uniforms. Uniform number one, uniform number two. For ceremony, we may wear something. You will see all these as defense officers wearing different costumes. You know, you might think there, but they are based on that event, some ceremony. So you have a dress. So we are given all those dresses. So they will say 3 minutes. They meaning our seniors. So remember, our seniors are all male cadets. We are called cadets when we are doing our training. So male cadets, 3 minutes. Dress number four. Now dress number one may have white color socks. Dress number two will have black color socks. Dress number one may have epaulets. Dress number five may have removed the epaulets. Dress number seven may have the kammarbund. Kammarbund is this special type with open collar, half sleeve white shirt, whereas dress number 12 may have the full sleeves white shirt all buttoned up here with a tie. 3 minutes, dress number so and so. So we are on the top floor of a building. That's where our rooms are. One full floor was given to us, and all of us run up those 3 steps, change, come down, report to the cycle stand. That was the center point. That was the point where all the ragda used to happen. Cycle stand, you come, 3 minutes. If you haven't made it into 3 minutes, separate. Go touch there from their front roll. Okay, we think that I've achieved it. I came within 3 minutes, so I'm very proud. Okay, after this, 3 minutes, dress number 15. Now, dress number 15 from dress number 7 means you have to change the socks, you have to change this thing, you have to change everything, and then come back, come down in 3 minutes. Okay, that also done. Again, latecomers given their own specification. And all the time you think, oh, I made it. Those who didn't make it are busy doing all this, running up, running there, doing front rolls and back rolls and doing hop, skip, jump, all of this. And then one fine day they say, nobody is, one person comes, has come in late. Okay, full course, all 12, do front roll, all 12, touch that. Touch the gate and come. Touch that. Do this. Do this. So the punishment was not for the person who's come late, but for everybody. Right? So that became like very unfair. And we had this one girl in our batch who was always late. Okay. So now this patti parade, if you remember. So we have to, if you remember, you take out your black socks, put on your white, put on white shoes or black shoes, depending on different types of shoes. Parade dress has a different type of shoe with a horseshoe and all of this. So one fine day, this child, this girl, woman, my coursemate, she wore the black socks over the white socks.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes,
pardon to interfere.
Time is
one
up.
One of our batch students are supposed to leave buses waiting.
Oh.
So I'm sorry to interfere.
Oh, and then I'll quickly then just wind up. Yeah.
Yeah. So Vaishag, any questions we can ask Leela ma'am now?
Actually, ma'am, every question was answered by ma'am's speech. Many questions came in, but everything was answered. Beautiful presentation, ma'am. Ma'am, you can quickly wind up, no issues.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because students are waiting.
Waiting. Yeah.
Are waiting.
Okay.
I'm really sorry to interfere.
No problem. No problem. And you can give them all my number and my mail ID. Yeah. Yes. So this, I'll just this thing.
Yeah.
This was one of the takeaways from the organization that I got. And what happened was after this this patti parade was going on, we suddenly realized that, you know, we are getting punished either way. So chuck it. So the next time they said 3 minutes, we all walked up. Nobody ran, no race, no nothing. We all walked. And we all waited there. We changed in our respective rooms and came out, waited for all 12 of us. And all 12 of us came together ready for the punishment. Everybody is ready for the punishment. And that time they said, Ragada is over for you. Yeah, this is the aim of the service, that you leave aside your personal goals and then just, you know, merge into one team, wherein that's how a war is going to be fought, isn't it? That we, I've actually reached my memories, and this is being the first batch. You can see I was with the president and the prime minister at that time. That is President Shankar Dayal Sharma and his wife, and of course, P.V. Narasimha Rao. And this was during the Air Force Day parade. So if you see, this is the Kamarband, at the bottom, this top, this is the Kamarband. Beautiful times. These are all lovely. The thing that I would have loved to show you some more pictures. I thought I would share. And in fact, we all 12 girls. We met again after 25 years in 2018. So these are the first batch, the Dirty Dozen or the Dangerous Dozen. And all 12 of us in the same order, we are standing here at the same place where we did our training, that is Air Force Academy. And it has been a brilliant organization. I am so sorry I have delayed so much. And maybe I wish your school had, stretchable times. Sorry.
True. Very true.
Yeah. So touch the sky with glory. That's the motto. And a huge takeaway that I have is that life is full of struggles. Life is full of challenges. Take them up. Just take them up. Nothing. It's not the end of the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I don't know what to say from the beginning till the end. It was packed with so much knowledge, so much motivational inspiration. So much was there that really too less time for this. We should have had a longer period of time for such sessions, and in future definitely we will be arranging more, if possible, in person to have you with us for more such talks and presentation. And a lot of work behind this preparation, everything you have done so wonderfully. I don't know whether I should call you a resource person or an educator or a motivational speaker. It's a mixed feeling, but on behalf of DMI's management, principal, and entire students, I extend deep gratitude to you for sharing such wonderful moments with us. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, students, and enjoyed. I'm sure you have enjoyed. Keep the questions ready. We will catch ma'am again sometime later. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you, ma'am.
That's me doing the ragada, by the way.
You can see that.
Thank you, Miss Lila Shaju. I'm the principal, Miss Padmini. You know, it was, I don't have word to say. I joined in the middle. Sorry, I'm extremely sorry for that. It was very motivational speech, very informative. You know, you have spent your precious time with us. Really, we are grateful to you. You know, believe me, I'm hats off to our Army, Navy, and the Air Force people. Today, we are safe and happy because of them. You know, otherwise, we are not happy, believe me. Hats off to those people. I mean, it's from the bottom of my heart. My kids, my students have many things to take from, you know, today to take. Definitely, they should think what they should do next. What I want to tell you is, like, especially for these kind of profile, like whether Army, Navy, or Air Force, you need more dedication and commitment. If you are not 100% committed, if you are not 100% dedicated, I don't think it's going to work out. So once again, on behalf of entire DMIS fraternity, really, I would like to thank you. Thank you so much. We would like to have more sessions. Thank you so much. And your preparation, you know, I don't have word to say. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I did it in 2 days, but then that's all right. And I have to show you this. This is after 25 years. And can you see she's the officer who filed the suit against the Indian Air Force for permanent commission. And today—
Well, who is that, ma'am? Who is that?
She is my coursemate. I'll just move. So she's my coursemate and her name is Wing Commander Anupama Joshi. So both of us, when we went for a reunion in 2018, that is a cycle stand where we would do our push-ups. So we got into push-up position. You know? So that's it. Anyway, thanks. It was my pleasure all totally and anytime. And you can, Vaishak, I can share my email ID.
So my kids are thrilled, I believe now. Right, Vaishak?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, definitely.
Any more queries? I'm so sorry.
Sure,
overstepped your time, but it was my pleasure.
No, it's okay. It was not boring. Definitely, it was not boring.
All right, good.
So you can go another half an hour. Thank you so much.
Okay.
So once again, thank you, ma'am. A big salute to you from entire DMS. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Good day.
Thank you. Yeah, have a good day, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. That is all. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us, students. Tomorrow we'll be having a session on journalism and architecture. We have Ms. Sindhu Nair joining us tomorrow. Please do join in at the same time. Once again, a big thank you to Ms. Lila Shaji for joining us today and educating us about the defense sector. Thank you, ma'am. And we shall formally conclude our session here. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.